Good afternoon. I'm Scott Hofer. I'm the director of the Center on Aging here at the University of Victoria, and delighted to have this here on our campus. I want to begin by acknowledging with respect the Coast Salish and Strait Salish peoples on whose traditional territories this lecture series is focusing. Members of the Center on Aging are engaged in a variety of interdisciplinary research with new and existing research alliances with Island Health. We have heard some of the speakers earlier this morning and several more this afternoon. I am between you and the first speaker, but I want just to say a few things about some of the activities of the Center on Aging and the supports of the CIHR for many of these kinds of research activities as well. In terms of CIHR funding and funding priorities, we're seeing this is really quite an exciting time. Certainly, the technology evaluation of the elderly network, why we're here today, but also the eHealth Innovation Partnership Program, or eHIP, and I'm aware of at least three successful applications that have some basis here at the University of Victoria. This is all about identifying patient-oriented research and health solutions to improve outcomes, patient experience, and lower the cost of care, very much in alignment with the TBN network activities. Also, a great emphasis on precision or personalized medicine. We're seeing a great deal of work in the U.S. and across Canada, and I think these kinds of innovations also play into caring for frail elderly better and better. In terms of other activities, the Canadian Longitudinal Study of Aging has one of the major sites here at the University of Victoria, Vancouver Island. And this is about a very large-scale study of 50,000 individuals, 30,000 seen in person across Canada. And it's focusing on midlife and late life determinants of changes in health and dementia and disability. Also, the Canadian Consortium on Neurodegeneration and Aging has a number of investigators here on Vancouver Island and certainly elsewhere. And this is all about the dementia and the other disorders that affect the quality of life and quality of services across our populations as well. So these are the major funding initiatives, major priorities, there's a number of others that relate to these kinds of things we're talking about today. I just wanted to bring it, just to have a few comments to bring us into an even larger picture of lifespan development, or life course epidemiology. The idea that much of what we see in later life, in terms of chronic disease, risk for chronic disease, risk for dementia, lifespan, are related to things that happen to us much earlier in life than throughout our life. So it's the study of a variety of hazards or risks associated with low socioeconomic status, primarily in early life contexts, associated with parenting, with stress, with lack of stimulation during gestation, childhood, adolescence, young adulthood, later adult life, and how all these play out and unfold over the lifespan to modify our risks and our health outcomes much later in life. These types of studies, this research, focuses on very long-term patterns across the life course. It involves a variety of studies in terms of historical changes and generational differences across growth cohorts, with an emphasis on the modifiability of risk factors and critical periods where interventions might have their greatest impact. So it's a very rich source of research that also plays out in terms of later life outcomes and frailty, but looking much more at the development about the variety of risk factors as they play out across each of our lives. I won't go into this at all. It has a very rich and detailed theoretical, a conceptual model. This comes from Diane Kuhn's book on Life Course Approach to Aging, or came out last year. And there's a variety of resources. So this is a very rich area of activity in terms of bringing together many of the long-term longitudinal studies. Many of these studies began when these individuals were infants. And studies are, have followed them up for over 70 years. So we have very long, certainly some data sets that allow us this very, very long-term picture, moving picture, of individuals as they develop and allow us to understand how these early life determinants matter for later life outcomes. And you've already heard from Rick Zalutsky and others about how the technology and the kinds of devices, the kinds of ways that we can unobtrusively monitor changes within individuals is really changing our whole research environment. So this has been called EFE, or remote objective assessments, and there's a variety of ways we can do this and embed this to better understand the kinds of changes and the kinds of potential interventions that might matter. And the other thing is, it's quite exciting for me as a developmental psychologist and as a statistician, is working with healthcare systems themselves. And certainly our partnership here at the University of Victoria with Island Health is very exciting, and I think it's going to lead to a great impact of our own research directly to improving the health of our community. And so embedding these kinds of studies, these kinds of monitoring in the healthcare system, I think will benefit us all. One of the things I do is I direct an international network of longitudinal studies of aging and dementia, comprised now of over 100 longitudinal studies. And what we do is we bring these studies together to ask new questions, but also do so in a way that permits us to strongly replicate findings across studies, to really compare directly the results of one study with many others. And that's been funded by NIH, and it's meant to make maximal use of existing long-term longitudinal data. And so some of the questions we're asking have to do with frailty and have to do with the developmental course that leads to frailty. Working with Ken Lockwood and Josh Armstrong right now to develop some new projects along this line, again, making use of many of these existing data sources. The area of precision medicine I mentioned, really focusing on genetic differences, but in my view, focusing also on within-person change. And detecting change and variation very early in the process, where it's much more likely to be, where interventions are much more likely to have their impact. Certainly in the area of dementia, this is where a lot of our research is going, and it's all about making people more regularly, repeatedly, so that we can begin to detect these change points that mark these very early changes associated with neurodegenerative disorders. And I mentioned one of our EGIP applications. This is with Morgan Price and Jens Weber and others here. That really focuses on bringing a variety of devices and technology into the homes of individuals with complex chronic conditions. So really, again, focusing on keeping people healthy and as independent as long as possible. And this just shows how we're really making some connected devices of surveys, of cognitive assessments, in such a way that we were able to feed this back not only to the individual, to the patient, but also to the providers, and also use it as a source of basic research. So in the end, I think it really is all about that with the strategy for patient-oriented research, with the kinds of activities that are being presented here today, of bringing together very basic science, understanding the processes related to diseases, risk factors associated with that, with clinical practice to improve care, and always engaging our community and patients, us, in this whole process.